The rumors Gabor had overheard were true. Scouts returned with news of a cavern at whose mouth lay rotted logs, an indication that something of great weight may have been rolled inside. Chests full of gold, for instance. Then again, paw tracks clearly showed some beasts had made the cave their home.
Right. Decision time. Enter or scramble back down,
said Gascon, rubbing his hands together for warmth.
Please hurry. This frost is downright biting.
We've scaled this high. Foolish we'd be to descend empty-handed. Fall in behind me!
The queen took the four, sword in one hand, torch in the other. The flickering flame's glow illuminated the cave's interior, casting long shadows. Meave was certain some horror would leap at her at any moment. And she was not at all wrong.
Anyone here struggle with strong reservations when entering monster-infested pits? Asking for a friend.
Got any vettles? Hungry like a wolf, I am.
And just when you thought things were about to get dull.
Lady Margarita told us of this.
Your life is mine now.
I smell a leak.
One bolt.
Give me a target.
Sorry, eh? Turnips back for an encore!
Thank you.
When will you ever learn?
For you, pal! Anything! Treasure trove ought to be close now. Come on!
As soon as the last beast had fallen, the Lyrians took to seeking out the treasure. Soldiers dispersed throughout the caverns in a rush, penetrating every last corner. Finally, one called out.
Got it! Got the treasure! Right here! Treasure! Shiny stuff!
A number of steel-reinforced chests lay up against the cavern wall. Meave blew the dust from the lid of one and lifted it with some difficulty. She had hoped for gold and jewels, bars of Mahakaman steel at the least. Instead, she saw thousands of time-tarnished copper coins with a hole through their center.
What's this bloody crap? Tokens of some sort?
Aye, that's right. Holy guldens, we call them. They're, currency in Mahakam. Get our wages in them. Use them to cop victuals and hooch.
What of arms? Armor? Tools?
Nah. Oh, that's given to us. Clan provides it. Is that what you need? Weapons? Oh, feel the agent now. Brought you here for no reason.
Yet these tokens, they can be exchanged for other coin, can they not? Temerian orans or Novigrad crowns?
Aye. Doable in theory, but not at all clever. Rates are crap. See, the elders keep them low to make life difficult for dwarven folk. Discourage them from leaving Mahakam.
What's this? Common dwarves use no gold. You cannot be serious.
Yet I am. What good's gold to them? Clan gives them all they need. And victuals and hooch beyond need, they get for tokens.
Yet you trade with humans. Gold coin you take for your goods, the coin must serve a purpose. What is it?
We hoard it all. In vaults. Great piles. Down bottom lie ducats dating from the reign of that dozy hamshanker, King Dagrid.
And you do not put it to use? Acquire anything for it? Then it's true what folks say, that you love gold too much to part with it. Hoard it for pleasure, as dragons do.
Point of fact, that there's pure drivel. Gold's a metal like any other, just yellow. We hoard it for our safety.
Your safety? I fear again, I simply don't follow.
Couldn't it be simpler? Soon as human folk get it in their heads, we's a thorn in their side, we'll spend it. All of it, in a jiffy. Excess coin supply, that's called. Matter of days, gold'll be worth less than sawdust. And you're tossing banks and economies, bam, on their arses. There'll be nothing left of them. They'll cave in faster than a mineshaft with rotten props. Why are you all ogling me? With human folk for neighbours, we dwarves got to be damn vigilant. As sheep round wolves.
So how can these tokens serve me?
We must trade them. Even should we get a pittance, it will be something. The soldiers demand their pay.
Ach, your bums out the windy. Fighting men want full dixies and tankards of hooch. Coins but a means to that end.
What do you suggest, then?
As I've been saying, the tokens we use to purchase nourishment and mead, and what you've got in those chests, why, that'll do to fund a feast the likes of which Mahakam's not seen since Bruver was sworn in as Elder-in-Chief. The fighting men'll eat and drink their fill, carouse about and forget their due and pay right quick. And invite the local dwarves to feast with you, and the clans'll look kinder on you too.
Caution be damned.
Your Grace, I feel obliged to remind you we are at war with Nilfgaard, and every copper...
should go to building our army, I know. But we live but once, Reynard. Sir Gabor, take the tokens and arrange me a feast so grand that Ebdahi himself shall hear us revel.
As Meave's force could not possibly fit in a tavern, the feast was laid out in a storehouse. Crates arranged in rows served as tables and benches, while the windows were festooned with lion's foot and pasque flower. Great barrels of mead, cognac, and vodka were rolled in, and when the soldiers saw this, they broke out in cheers and laughter that lasted till dawn.
Pour us another round, you lovable Lyrian bastards!
Faerie's a jolly good fair... a jolly good dwarf.
There was food and drink enough for the dwarves of the pass, who, with Meave's men, raised tankards in hand and voices in song the night through. To see them sharing tales and playing cards, one would not believe that anywhere down the mountains, through woods and across plains, humans and dwarves might, for the softest slight, leap at each other, murder in their eyes.
The dwarves we need, every hood's a Dunderheed!
"M'lady," whispered one of the scouts.
"Left of the path."
Meave squinted. The Nilfgaardians had taken shelter from the falling snow under a rocky outcropping. The smell of roasting meat wafted from their campfire, and echoes of laughter could be heard. The black-clad soldiers had reason to celebrate. They had just decimated Meave's company without even drawing their weapons. Meave's gaze caught something else. A metal container into which the Nilfgaardians tossed bones once they'd been gnawed clean. It looked strangely familiar. Only after a moment did the Queen understand it was an overturned Lyrian helmet dug out of the snowy grave of one of her men.
The whoresons!
Meave hissed.
They'll pay for this.
Meave! Asking your last time, keep a cool head!
Whispered Gabor.
You want vengeance? I get it. But think of the cost. If so much as a hair gets plucked from Ovain's head, Bruver will never forgive you, and you can kiss any hope of aid goodbye.
Silence followed, finally to be broken by one of the scouts.
Milady, what's the order? Do we attack?
Await my signal.
The Queen stepped out from behind the rocks, put a hand to her mouth, and yelled,
Ovain! Ovain at Clenvog!
All laughter stopped in the Nilfgaardian camp. Moments later, a sumptuously dressed man stepped in front of the wagons. He wiped a thick sauce from his lips, then bowed with an exaggerated courtly flourish.
Queen, my condolences. That avalanche, oh, what an unfortunate turn of events.
The mountains can be unpredictable,
Meave said with a shrug.
Accidents can happen at any time.
Oh, yes?
Even right now.
Meave leapt towards the emissary, placed two hands on his neck, and hurled him into a rock with all her might. The Nilfgaardian's head slammed against the stone, and his skull crumpled with a sickening crack. He fell to the ground and writhed a few final tremors.
Attack!
Meave roared.
Take no prisoners!
Quan and Lyrian!
My boots got sand a plenty in me.
Take no prisoners!
Have it the white of an eye from half a league away.
There's a time to reap, a time to sow, and a time to die.
A knight should help. Our codex commands it.
Wise choice.
Take it anymore.
life is mine now!
Give me a target.
That was nothing to spell books.
Coin never stinks, no matter how rank the pouch.
Now, how did that incantation go?
There's been a mistake. I'm no mage.
Praise be to the great sun!
All routes lead to Nilfgaard. Order will triumph. It must triumph.
We should not have done this.